Well, President Carter, when he was with me a few moments ago, was talking about how trade is important and warning this president not to botch it. When you were president, did the markets matter to you? They matter to this president. He mentions them a lot, thinks they're very important. What do you think?
Yes, the markets were very important to me because I thought that having a fair and equitable relationship with as many countries around the world as we possibly could, and friendship with them and maximum trade with them was good for America in the long term and good for individual Americans as well.
All right. So if we have a deal with Mexico and Canada has to wait, then what will the markets do with that? And does the president own the same markets if they go south? You know the drill here. So does Wall Street Journal editorial, a board member, former speech writer Bill McGurn, Making Money host Charles Bain. Last but not least, Fox Business's Christina Partsnevelis. All right. So Bill, to you on this notion that the president's got to move carefully here. What
right.
do you think?
Well, look, the Mexican minister said that the best part of this is it removes uncertainty, right? President Trump has threatened to blow up NAFTA. People are happy that it's not blown up, and they, because they're happy about that, they might accept some parts of it that they would otherwise not accept in principle. For example, the new figures for the percentage of domestic content for a car and so forth. We're pretty much unregenerate free traders, so I don't really like the managed part of the deal. I mean, in Europe, the president...
You said this is worse. That is the journal editorial that this is worse than what we had.
Yeah, well, look, it's... In Europe, the president's pursuing a policy that I think is the right one on cars. He says our ideal world is where they have zero tariffs on our stuff and we have zero tariffs on their stuff. In Mexico, it seems to be a little bit different. We want to negotiate a formula for managed trade, and we're just not.
You're not keen on it.
We're not managed trade folks.
Charles Payne canceled his journal subscription, right? I mean, you disagree.
Well, I think something's going on here where the elite of the corporate world are missing big time.
And McGurn.
Yes, the McGurns of the world. No, but really, there's something going on where it was already a managed deal, NAFTA. So if it's managed at 62.5% of parts, automobiles being assembled in North America, some people think 75% means more opportunities for American workers to get a job. Now, the initial reaction yesterday, one of the best performing groups in the market were auto parts companies. BorgWarner surged. It was up 4 or 5%. So the market seemed to like it yesterday. I think the American worker will like it. I think those people who are worried about flight because of, for economic reasons, with a $16 threshold, certainly, obviously, it would helps Mexico. But again, you know, these mechanisms were already in place. So I think if you're dealing with the hand you're dealt, in this particular case, this is what Trump was dealt. And to Bill's point, if he wanted to drive a harder deal and blow this whole thing up, we could have been talking about something that could have gone on for months or years and never gotten done. I think the market's happy it's done. I think it's a little bit better deal for all players involved. And I think the elites have to be very careful because it always sounds like they're talking about corporate profit margins whenever they push back on this stuff. And I'm going to tell you right now, you know, we just saw the Gallup survey, 18 to 29-year-olds rejecting capitalism. That's the headline. Not Democrats embracing socialism. Young adults in America are rejecting capitalism because of this kind of stuff.
May I interject and say about this deal being done, the fact that it still needs to go through Congress for 90 days. Canada has a parliamentary process, which means that they're going to review it for quite some time. So I don't actually think that they're going to be on board with this. And they
have. You don't think Canada will be on board?
I think that they have time because there's a quote even from the Prime Minister saying, Prime Minister Trudeau saying that a no deal is better than a bad deal. So they're not going to rush
to. He's not going to be bullied into this.
That's the whole view, too, is his image is at stake right now. And already there's contention. They're not getting along between the United States and Canada, and that's being very visible. You have 90 days to go through Congress. Like Edward said in that report, November 30th would be the deadline for Canada to join. However, the United States is pushing right now, and Mexico, to say officially that this deal is done by this week. Why? You have midterms. You have the switchover of the new president in Mexico. So I think timing for them is really important, and to say that it is a done deal and say it's a win. However, NAFTA is still going to be in full force for the next 6 months. Nothing's going to change.
What do you think, Bill?
Well, I'd go back to the original point. Yes, NAFTA was not a bad deal, but I think it had a lot of managed parts that were not good. But I think the answer is to go in the good direction, where he said, as in Europe, zero tariffs. Look, I think what the president if I were the president from his point of view, not from my point of view, he doesn't like multilateral agreements. He likes bilaterals. He should have gone to Britain, which needs a deal because of Brexit, and say, we'll have the cleanest deal with zero tariffs, because their economy and ours, it's kind of the easiest to do, and come up with the cleanest trade deal you can, and then say, this is open to any other country. You know, when they talk about the workers, let's be clear, this helps some workers, maybe in the car industries, but it raises the prices for other workers, right? I mean, the definition of a good company, by definition, is almost one that's competitive in the market, not one that needs protection.
We're up on it to Charles's point, then they're okay with that, right?
Well, during this whole saga, we saw, you know, people, we've done reports from the nail company, and we've done reports from the fishing guy, you know, with three, you know, might lose his fishing boat. What we never did a report on that I haven't seen is maybe one of the 7 million Americans who think they lost their job to trade, and maybe their kid who's hooked on fentanyl because his dad didn't have a job and he didn't have anyone to look up to. Maybe we never did those kind of stories on a societal destruction that a lot of people who voted for Trump were hoping he would try to resolve through these kind of deals.
But are these deals bringing us in that direction?
I think it helps. There's no magic bullet. Listen, these are complicated multi-trillion-dollar trade deals. They've been in place. This is 24 years. World Trade Organization is an extension of the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade of 1948. They're old, antiquated, and at the very least, they needed to be tuned up.
I agree. And just to weigh in, and you were bringing up zero tariffs and how that's the ultimate goal, but given our society right now across the globe and moving towards nationalistic countries, patriotism, how are we going to ever achieve zero tariffs?
Well, I think it should still be the goal.
Subsidies like crazy, especially
in
Canada.
Well, my answer is don't increase the subsidies.
But then what about, we just did it in the United States very recently to offset this tariff.
Yeah,
situation.
I'm just saying it's not good.
No, I know.
Because if there's something that you regard as incorrect or incomplete, it seems to me the answer is to try to address that and to have a goal, which the president claims to have in Europe, and we have a different goal over here. And again, we talk about elites. Let's be careful. You said the oil companies, these other companies, they love this stuff. It's protection. It reduces the competition. The average Joe is going to see the price of a car go up.
But
Mexico,
the average worker will see his or her wage go up.
Maybe not the average worker, but some workers in some protected industries will, but other workers will be paying more out of their paychecks because of that.
Well, we've had 400,000 new manufacturing jobs since Trump has been in office. We were told that was impossible, absolutely impossible to achieve. We got a consumer confidence number in today, the highest since October of 2000. The other part of this is, the equation is, before I'm a consumer, I need a job. So I think most Americans, at least those in the heartland, are going to say, before we do the chicken and egg thing, give me a job first, and then I'll worry about how expensive my car is. Because let's face it, I mean, people in a prosperous society, we're not even buying cheap cars, right? We could do a segment next on the death of the automobile in the United States. We're buying those expensive SUVs and those expensive crossovers because prosperity is back.
Christina, final thought?
Just to add, the second part of that equation is the prices that you just brought up. If this deal goes through, we have to buy more U.S. local steel so we can hit that 80% capacity. But that and inevitably will increase prices in the United States, not just for cars, but for aluminum and steel products.
Let's not forget it. It's going to take a while to come online, but imagine this. Our aluminum capability is at the level it was at the end of World War II. We could have a war with China in 10 or 15 years. I know people say, hey, we could always get the steel or an aluminum from Canada, but really, when we need to build battleships and warplanes, we're going to be sitting around waiting for a shipment? There are some legitimate concerns about that.
All right, guys, thank you all very, very much.